Hello and welcome to the ADC Forum series, Surviving the Crisis and Building the Future Amid the COVID-19 Pandemic. Today we're talking about public policy and the focus for building the future with Dr. Jim Chalmers, who's the Shadow Treasurer of the Australian Government, has been since 2019. He's a member for Rankin in Queensland since 2013 and in the Shadow Cabinet since 2015. He's one of Federal Opposition's most thoughtful, experienced and knowledgeable contributors to public policy ideas. And he's written two books over the last decade or so following the financial crisis, one called Glory Days in 2013. He's also written one more recently, which he co-authored, called Changing Jobs, the Fair Go in the New Machine Age. He has a PhD in political science and international relations and first class honours degree in public policy. And I guess, Jim, you've been no stranger to the vortices of public policy challenges and global crises with your involvement in the management of the global financial crisis. You've also written a book about it. We'd be really keen for you to share with us your thinking on this crisis of COVID-19 and how you're starting to orient your policy thinking towards what we need as a country to come through this harrowing period. Over to you.
Thanks very much, Anton, for the characteristically kind introduction, but also for the invitation to spend time with the ADC today. I've been a relatively regular participant in the discussions with the group, and I really value them. And one of the reasons I value those conversations, and one of the reasons why I'm pleased to be with you today is because you give us an opportunity to kind of get above the politics of the day and to focus on economic policy in my case, but also to focus properly on the future, recognising that what we're going through now really is, you know, quite extraordinary in every way. In a week, we've just finished a parliamentary sitting fortnight. I'm still in Canberra because I'm off to Eden Monaro shortly to campaign in the by-election. So this has had a sort of a circle around it in the diary, metaphorically, because it gives us an opportunity to talk about, to take all of the politics out of it and just to focus on the economic, and focus on, you know, what we need to be doing now and what we need to be doing into the future. And what I thought I'd suggest in just getting the conversation started before we go to some questions is, I think the most useful way to view this crisis, you know, recognising that Australia has performed really extraordinarily well in terms of limiting the spread of the virus itself, you know, most of the focus rightly now is on the economic consequences of that. And I think the best lens to view that through is really the labour market. I think there's so much that the labour market tells us about this crisis more than any other kind of chunk of the conversation. And especially when, you know, not even 24 hours ago, we got some really confronting data on the labour market. 835,000 Australians lost a job in the last 2 months. More than 600,000 gave up looking. A real unemployment rate of something like 11.3% when you factor that all in, really quite, you know, remarkably confronting figures. And so most of the thinking that we do in the Federal Opposition, I think most of the economists I interact with, most of the conversations I have with CEOs and chairs of companies really begins with some consideration of the labour market. It also is helpful, I think, to think about what we're trying to avoid here. When we think about all the components of the policy agenda, what are we trying to avoid? In my mind is we're trying to avoid that kind of long-term unemployment, that scarring in the labour market that comes with recessions that we saw in the early 90s with people who were disconnected from our work, found it very hard and some found it impossible to find their way back in. That's really the kind of overarching concern that we have when we think about how we deal with all of this. So we're trying to avoid that. The other sort of perspective I'd put on the table before we chat is that, you know, with a challenge this big, an economic challenge, you know, as confronting as this, as massive as this, I think it helps to break it down into kind of stages of the challenge. I know that a lot of your members would do that in terms of how they're dealing with the crisis in their own businesses. A lot of people I speak to talk about, you know, whether it's the way that you organise your direct reports, whether it's the way that you organise your agendas for your kind of blue sky discussions or your, you know, crisis management discussions, is to break it into parts. And from our point of view, there's really three parts to this. The first part is how we respond and kind of triage the immediate crisis. The second part is how we bolster the recovery, recognising that private demand will come back. In some areas, it will come back fast. In a lot of areas, it will come back slow. And so what do we need to do from a government point of view to bolster the recovery until that private demand recovers? And then thirdly, how do we set the place up for the future? And so a couple of kind of, centerpieces for each of those stages. In terms of triaging the immediate crisis, there's been some good things that the government has done, certainly at a kind of conceptual level. Wage subsidies are a good idea. We've got some issues around how they're being implemented, but that's how we triage the immediate crisis. The most important decision there is the future of the JobKeeper payment. Many of you would be contemplating that last weekend in September when JobKeeper ends, what that means for businesses. And I've heard in private conversations about a lot of companies that they're worried about what their workforce looks like, how big it is when that support ends. So that's the kind of key decision in that immediate period. How we bolster the recovery? Well, there's no shortage of ideas there. I think the best one that we've kind of added to the conversation, which we'd like to see more of, is around the kind of public housing build, because what you're looking for in bolstering the recovery is something that's labour intensive, has a local impact and has a lasting impact. And maybe public housing is one, important policy objective that ticks all three of those boxes. And then thirdly, in terms of setting the place up for the future, and we're putting a heap of work into this, we kind of recognise that, we are not the biggest part of the conversation in the near term, and so we're trying to use our time wisely to think about the future of the economy. Our concern is that a lot of the issues that we had in the economy before the crisis will reemerge, after the recovery starts to gather pace. There was an issue with business investment, as you all know. There was an issue with productivity, issues around financial pressure on households, household debt, etc. And so what we're trying to work out is how do we avoid just going back to whatever normal was? How can we do better than what normal used to be? And for us, there's a heap of emphases there, but my personal emphases are, how do we get some certainty back into energy investment? How do we get the skills and training, human capital side right, particularly when we think about people trying to keep pace with technological change? And thirdly, how do we get this, how do we kind of crack this commercialisation nut that's been worrying us for a long time? How do we turn our ideas into jobs in its simplest form, but how do we get research and development right so that we can move up the value chain in a lot of the industries, including some of those represented on the call today? So that's what the future economy looks like. And if you think about it through the labour market lens, the first stage that I talked about is about triaging those jobs, trying to maintain a connection between workers and employers. In terms of bolstering the recovery, it's how we get some labour-intensive, sensible, responsible interventions in the economy until private demand returns. And in the longer term, how do we create those new jobs by getting energy input costs down, getting the right skills mix in the economy, and making sure that we get the R&D side right as well. I think if we don't do at least those three things, then we risk coming out of this. The quarterly growth rate will look okay because we'll be getting those big percentage growth numbers off at a really low base. But what does growth actually look like after this? And I think without getting energy right, skills right, and R&D right, then we're probably selling ourselves short. So I might leave it there, Anton, just to put those ideas on the table and see if anybody wants to raise anything more specifically.
Thanks very much, Jim. That was a great encapsulation of, I guess, where we're at now, and I guess some of the work that you're doing both in looking at the current policies being put into play. You mentioned JobKeeper and some of the issues with that, but also building the future. So I think people will be really reassured to know that there's, in the middle of a crisis like this, such a profound crisis affecting the whole globe, that we're actually thinking quite strongly about the long-term policies that are critical as well. I guess in terms of the values, and you mentioned some of the problems that we were having before the crisis potentially re-emerging. Do you think there needs to be any change in sort of how we think of Australia as a society and as an economy going forward? I mean, you mentioned the focus on unemployment as being a real concern, as well as the sort of the innovation, I guess, edge of the Australian economy. Like, are there broader values that we need to be thinking about in terms of going forward?
Yeah, there are a heap of those, but I think two stand out the most for me. One's very local and one's very international. In a local sense, you know, everybody has, in one way or another, had a change to how they work. A lot of industries don't have the luxury of working, you know, 5 days a week from home, but some do. And even for those who work away from home, things have obviously been, you know, the pace of change has accelerated because of what's been imposed on us by the virus and the necessary response to it. And, you know, you hear stories about companies that had a 3-year plan to get to some of their workforce doing 2 days a week from home. They implemented that 3-year plan in 3 weeks. I know some of the banks have done really quite remarkable things with 20,000 workers working from home, and others are in a similar boat. So I think that's one of the big changes, that how we've had to reconsider much faster than we anticipated how, not just what work we do, but how we actually do it. And clearly most people in the corporate world are trying to work that looks like after, the most dire part of the pandemic threat has subsided. And what that makes me think about is, and I see it in my own neighbourhoods, is what does that mean for kind of suburban renewal? Our CBDs are crucial, obviously, and there's been some good thinking put into how we make CBDs part of the productivity story, we make them efficient. But I think there also needs to be a conversation about suburban renewal and livability. And the way, the sort of granular way I think about that is, you know, one of the few upsides of this, devastating virus is people are in their communities more, they're exercising more, they're utilising green space more because there's few other options, they're, you know, eating better, getting healthier, all that sort of thing. And in some parts of Australia, that's, you know, the suburbs are a beautiful place to live, but in other places they're quite difficult. And I think it should sort of force a conversation about, if people are working from home more or working nearer to home more, how do we make that experience better for those suburbs which don't have a lot of amenities and green space and all the rest of it. So that's part of it. That's a very local example. But then on the other big thematic change, I think, which troubles me greatly, and I'm sure troubles you given your interests, I know, is this kind of like reflexive isolationism, if not kind of nativism, that is emerging. We would be doing ourselves a massive disservice if we retreated on kind of global engagement, trade, all of those sorts of things. We can't let this thing be an excuse for everyone to kind of retreat, to turn the clock back 30 or 40 or 50 years into a place that we then have to recreate some of the kind of engagement which has been unquestionably good, especially for a middle power like us.
I guess we can come back to the domestic situation, but just as you pick up the trade situation, what do you see as the way forward in terms of that? Because Australia, it has been a very strong trading nation, and we have at the same time, so there are these increasing concerns. And one of our viewers asks the question around around what's been happening with China in terms of some of the diplomatic or not so diplomatic comments that have been made towards Australia. And the question is, how much decoupling from China economically and politically is needed and affordable, and how can it be achieved? That's a question from one of the viewers.
Yeah. Well, first of all, we've got to decide whether that would be desirable. I mean, I don't think, decoupling the, from the economic benefit would be wise for us. Clearly, in some sectors of the economy, we discovered or it was emphasised how reliant we were on Chinese markets for the success of some of our industries. Clearly, when the borders first closed, the education sector took a, extremely heavy hit, and that made people think about the kind of mix there, which is appropriate. But I don't think we can or should, try and distance ourselves from the economic opportunities in China. And so that means that the challenge becomes how do we make sure that we are strengthening that economic relationship even when there is some complexity or some, some turbulence in the diplomatic exchanges. And I know companies are thinking that way. I mean, at the beginning of the crisis, people were thinking about, we weren't diverse enough, and I know that that's still a strain of thinking. But I don't think it's a desirable outcome for people to disengage or decouple from what will continue to be just extraordinary opportunities for us in China, no matter what the kind of politics of the day, imposes on that.
Mm. I mean, I think it certainly does continue to be a strain of thinking, as you suggest. There's another question around sovereign capability and our ability to regenerate that, and whether the economic stimulus packages we've seen now, whether there should be some continuation of investment into that sort of sovereign capability. What are your thoughts there?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a useful way to come at it, which is to think, what has this crisis taught us about our economy and particularly about our capability? You hear good stories about parts of the manufacturing sector being able to quickly kind of adapt and redeploy to making different kinds of goods. Everyone knows the sort of hand sanitizer story, PPE to some extent as well. But I think really, if a nation wakes up one day and says, okay, we want a bigger proportion of our economy to be manufacturing, for example, I think it's important to recognise that we don't just kind of flick switches and decide, we want, X percent more of our GDP to come from that sector or any sector. If we want to be better at manufacturing, every manufacturer I speak to, literally every single one, talks about energy costs. And it's important we have a conversation about emissions reduction and all that sort of thing. But the reason why I'm a believer in new energy technologies is because in the way that Ross Garnaut and others have written about, is I want to try and get your energy costs down. The economics of energy are compelling. They're almost undisputed now. But we don't have that kind of investment framework where people can invest in it with confidence. They know what the horizon looks like. If we were able to deliver that, and we wanted to do more manufacturing, then we'd be addressing one of the key reasons why manufacturing has been in decline. Similarly with the other pieces I mentioned before, skills and training, and particularly research and development and commercialisation. So if we want that sovereign capability, we've got to get the kind of underlying pieces right. We can't just decide that we want that and hope that people start entering a market which doesn't have those kind of underlying conditions sorted out yet.
Mm, that's a really good point in terms of making sure the supply side and the basis for productivity is strong, really, I guess, particularly in terms of energy. Do you see that there's a sort of follow-on aspect in terms of Australia's economic base being a very strong proportion of SMEs, and do you see that there's a need, given in the crisis now and post-JobKeeper, for there to be continuing support of SMEs in terms of manufacturing or retail or some of those other industries?
Yeah, very clearly in my view, not forever. I don't think the budget can sustain, a decade of, substantial intervention. But I also equally think that September is too soon to pull out some of this support out of the economy. That's a view that's been put by the Reserve Bank governor, in his characteristically thoughtful way. A lot of the economists, a lot of the CEOs and chairs and boards that I've interacted with the last month or so, they don't want to engage in the kind of political argy-bargy about that, nor do I today. But just from an economic point of view, now that we're recognising that the unemployment challenge here will have a longer tail, there'll be higher unemployment for longer, I don't think the focus of the discussion should be how do we pull this support out of the economy as soon as possible. I think there should be some flexibility. And I think the industry, and maybe it's because I'm a Queenslander and I know how many jobs we have there out of tourism, but tourism's the one that's easiest to understand in that context. It doesn't look like the international border is going to be open anytime soon. So if you're working in the travel industry or the tourism industry, and particularly in some of those regional centres like Cairns or Townsville in Queensland, the idea that you would lose kind of JobKeeper support and some of the other support in September and then try and make your way through to June or July or whatever it is, I don't think that stacks up economically. So I think there is a case for some longer-term support. It may be that the government comes at that. Certainly they've made noises about the arts and entertainment industry. They've made noises about tourism. They've made some announcements about childcare. I hope that they continue down that path because, the aggregate growth number will be one thing in September and December. But within that, there'll be a lot of patchiness and we don't want to see good businesses hit the wall because they couldn't, build that bridge, to use the government's language, between the end of JobKeeper and when things look a little bit more normal.
Mm. Do you see, as you look across the Pacific into the US, obviously there's some quite significant differences between those in terms of who have wealth and those who don't, and different levels of income, and that, you might put different arguments about what we're seeing in terms of the level of, I guess, civil unrest that's happening today. But certainly inequality is a major factor in the US as well. Do you think we're on the road to similar problems in Australia in terms of inequality?
Yeah, I mean, we have a big challenge there. I think of it slightly differently. I think the big challenge for us is actually immobility. The idea that inequality that exists in our society, not as pronounced as elsewhere, but enough to trouble us. I'm worried about that kind of cascading through the generations. It's probably partly coloured by the fact that I grew up in and represent now an area where there are pockets of extreme disadvantage. And I worry about the intergenerational part of that. I think if we could be anything, we'd be a country where, you're not, your life circumstances aren't dictated by the circumstances of your birth. And so inequality is a thing, but when it kind of multiplies and as a challenge when we're talking about multi-generational inequality and social immobility. And that's why, we need to get the early intervention programs right. We need to get early education right. All of those sorts of things, because our big chance to differentiate from what's happening in the US is actually to be more, to be the kind of mobile society that the Americans talk about, but which in recent years has kind of been framed.
I guess that mobile society, and I guess the values on local and enriching the environments that people live in Australia so they can actually become real contributors to that economy, is pretty key. And I guess long-term economic growth is going to be a result really of that productivity growth as well. I mean, Australia's been relying significantly on immigration for its economic growth for some time, built into the figures. What do you see as the trajectory going forward? Obviously, we've had a drop-off temporarily, perhaps, of some international students. But in terms of our reliance on immigration for economic growth, do you think we're going to be able to step out of that that cycle to have a sort of breakout productivity, if you like, eventually, that sort of ideal of the mobile society, perhaps?
Yeah, well, it's almost like a bizarre experiment. What would our economy look like without migration for a period? We're really learning how reliant how much we rely on immigration as a source of growth. It's factually true that without migration, the economy wouldn't have grown hardly at all, barely at all, in the lead up to the crisis. And so now we're seeing, you know, what that looks like in quite an extreme way. I'm a massive believer in the economic, well, social benefits, but the economic benefits of migration. We have been putting some thought into that, and Christina Keneally and others have made relatively high profile interventions into that conversation. But you know, the way that Commonwealth Treasury used to think about economic growth was productivity, participation, and population in relatively equal measure. And so I think that's still a neat way to think about it. You know, how do we get more participation stories? How do we get more people creating wealth and sharing in its benefits? Productivity is all of the ways that we get more of, get smarter, adopt and adapt to technology, all of that. The population is just as important. How do we get that mix optimally right? You know, we're seeing the consequences of not being able to rely on that third piece at the moment.
One of the I guess discourses around the crisis at the moment has been that it's great to have a broad-based strategic approach in terms of you know, particular economic stimulus packages, but actually nuancing those and managing the gaps that are created is something that's perhaps a different order of challenge. And you've obviously had experience in trying to sort of work with stimulus packages through major crises in the past. I mean, one of the potential gaps is the loss of jobs for older people. And we've seen that it's often harder for older people to come back to work once they lose their jobs anyway, and that's been perhaps exacerbated during COVID-19. How do we address that particular issue?
Yeah, I mean, clearly the impacts of the virus are felt disproportionately. You're right that you know, in recessions, it's typically the kind of older workers when they lose their jobs, they find it very difficult to get back in. That was certainly the experience of the early 1990s. Where we had that kind of really that scarring that I was talking about before of the labour market. If that gets out of control, it's very hard to kind of rein it in at some later point. This crisis is affecting older workers, but especially the youngest workers, especially women, and especially casual workers as well. And so really how you have to think about what we were calling stimulus, but really is a kind of a triage, is how do you make sure that the assistance reaches those groups? Unfortunately, and again, avoiding a partisan point here, but in terms of the design of the JobKeeper payment, a lot of those groups are left largely unaddressed. And one of the reasons why we gave the government, when we supported the legislation through the parliament, we also gave them the power to fix up some of these gaps without having to come back to the parliament, which is pretty extraordinary. We said to the treasurer, we gave him in legislation the ability to set the rules on who was in and who was out, because we thought ideally when it became obvious that some of these impacts were being felt disproportionately, you could fix that up quite quickly and get people wage subsidies and the like. That was our intention, because people will fall through the gaps. You know, even with the best intentions, there'll be gaps that need to be addressed, and we thought that was the most efficient way to do it. Some of those gaps are unaddressed. More broadly, the kind of comparison that you've drawn between the GFC and now, which I obviously think about, you know, a great deal, having sort of been around then and around now, there's a different complexity now. What we had then was a financial crisis imposed on us. Big fiscal response, not as big as now, but a big fiscal response, which was largely to put the government accelerator down until the private sector was ready to fill the gap. Objectively, I think that went reasonably well. You know, in global terms, it went remarkably well. The different complexity which the government is dealing with now is that the government has a foot on the accelerator and a foot on the brake at the same time for understandable reasons. The foot on the brake is to close down chunks of the economy because, you know, to limit the spread of the virus, but also the accelerator at the same time. So it's a different complexity. And what that means is that all of the kind of usual rules the lessons that we had learned from 2008 and 2009, some of them still apply, but some of them don't. And so they need to be flexible and adapt. They need to be have an open mind to new packages of support, or extending or tapering or targeting support as it becomes obvious that there are, you know, different complexities and challenges emerging.
Well, I guess why do you think there's been that simultaneous accelerator and brake action? And is that something that we should continue to see in terms of these packages, or are there issues around the way particular people think within the government in terms of approach to crisis management, or is it a reemergence of perhaps positions prior to the crisis as well?
I think there is a bit of the latter. I think that there are mixed views inevitably in, you know, not just in the government but in the broader community about what should happen next. I sort of acknowledge that. That's not unhealthy either, to kind of tease out and test out different perspectives. My kind of fear is that the government was kind of happy to briefly visit kind of intervention in the economy, but they don't want to stay there too long. There is an ideological aspect to that, I think. And I don't want that kind of ideology of any kind, not just their kind, to cloud what are good economic judgments. And I said yesterday when the jobs numbers came out, you know, when you get new data like that, which is really quite confronting, very, very troubling, you know, your economic response needs to be calibrated to that. And you don't want this kind of ideological argument to take over and to determine where the government goes next. We want it to be an economic argument, and there's an economic case to be a bit smarter about tapering and targeting JobKeeper, for example. And so let's sort of argue about what that looks like rather than arguing about some of the old kind of binary ideological contests that we had, you know, before the crisis.
So what do you see happening to unemployment once JobKeeper is removed in the next couple of months? You mentioned it's 11% now. Do you see that is going to spike significantly, or?
Yeah, look, I'm not an enthusiastic forecaster, but I rely on a couple of things. I mean, the Treasurer last night said on 7:30 with Lee Sales that he thought that there would be a further spike. He was talking about, I think, 8% in September. The 11.3 number was the real unemployment rate. We're at 7.1 headline unemployment. The Treasurer thinks that might be more like 8% by September based on Treasury forecasts. Certainly the Reserve Bank's got unemployment higher for longer in their forecasts. So I take my cues from there. But also I know from speaking to, you know, a heap of businesses the last little while, you know, I think there will be substantial job losses at the end of JobKeeper. I think, you know, a lot of companies will even when their parts of the economy reopen, they might reopen with 2/3 or 3/4 or 4/5 of the staff that they had before. And so I am worried about a spike in September, October. I'm also worried that, you know, all this money that was rightly spent on triaging the crisis, we want to make sure that all that bought us was avoiding an April-May problem and just creating a September-October problem. And that's why the tapering and the transitioning, you know, over a longer kind of glide path matters a lot, I think, because, you know, we don't want the shock to be in at the end of September, early October, having avoided some of the shock from earlier in the year.
Okay. Just coming back to, I guess, the longer term aspect, you mentioned investment in places and local environments and cities. How do you see this investment actually being applied? Do you see it going towards a number of middle urban hubs, or how do you see that sort of that spatial planning happening in terms of the investment that you're talking about?
Yeah, you can quite easily imagine, you know, the hub model. You can see that, you know, as many of you are sitting down and working out you know, do we need, you know, that much CBD office space? What are our workers telling us about the optimal number of days from home or with others? Is there a way that even in our, you know, professional services firms, for example, are they better off having, you know, four hubs 20 minutes from the city, or the maintaining a big hub in the middle of the city? All of those sorts of things. I think it'll be in lots of ways kind of corporate-led, listening to your workforces. But, yeah, it's easy to imagine that hub model. It's easy to imagine, you know, many families with young kids at my house a couple of days a week, you want to drop off some things. What does that mean for, you know, local transport? What does that mean for all those sorts of things? I think it'll be driven really by workforce demand. But in some of the big growth corridors of our major cities, you know, out to the west of Melbourne, out to the west of Sydney, Brisbane, Gold Coast, where I live, Brisbane, Ipswich. A lot of those suburbs have sprung up as commuter suburbs, and not necessarily as suburbs where people spend 80% of their time. And I think when that demand emerges, local councils and state governments in particular, but with a federal interest, will need to build some local amenity there. Otherwise, people's standard of living will, instead of going up as a consequence of working from home, will go down.
Mm. It doesn't look like inflation's a particular problem at the moment, but you mentioned you're focused on unemployment, that being perhaps one of the most significant long-term issues to be a result of this crisis and for planning going forward. How do you see the relationship between inflation and unemployment as part of that trajectory? Do you think does that continue to be an issue? Obviously, there's the Phillips curve, but, you know, others have discredited that too. So what's your view?
Yeah, I mean, clearly the inflation hasn't been a challenge for us for some time. I remember back in the early 2000s writing speeches about our inflation challenge and all of that, and that seems a distant memory now, and the priority should be employment. You know, there's very little evidence, even when our growth was kind of moderate rather than weak, that we had an emerging problem with inflation. And so I don't think that will be a drama in the kind of near or medium term. But that doesn't mean it won't reemerge at some point down the track. A lot of forums I do, people want to talk about modern monetary theory and the like, as if inflation will never again be a challenge. But clearly, you know, nothing lasts forever. But in the medium term and near term, our priority should be over all else, I think.
Yeah, that's an interesting point, that sort of modern monetary theory that's been talked about, and, you know, I guess quite controversially as well. Do you have a view on modern monetary theory?
Yeah, I'm not an enthusiast, and I get a lot of emails as a consequence of that. There is a constituency for it out there, you know, some quite prominent economists, particularly out of the University of Newcastle, but I'm not an enthusiast. I think there should be fiscal intervention in the economy, obviously, in crisis time, and that's, you know, I think that's self-evident. But I worry about not having constraints on government spending. Totally unconstrained government spending, I don't think is optimal. I also don't think we'll never again have an inflation challenge in the economy. And thirdly, I think the world would view us differently. The world would view our money markets much differently if we went down that path. There wouldn't be a lot of confidence in us as a nation and the way that people rate our stuff. And so those are three good reasons not to go down the path. But I think it does recognise the fact that there's a constituency for it. I think it recognises the fact that, you know, the economic challenges are dire and that there needs to be some kind of intervention. And to that extent, I support that. Yeah, those motivations, if not the mechanism.
Yeah, no, fair enough. You mentioned debt likely to be an issue going forward. How do you see that the country manages the debt situation from the crisis?
I mean, it's the debt levels when we emerge from this are going to be stupendous, and, you know, obviously unprecedented. I think that the thing that people don't really recognise, perhaps you guys do, but, you know, our public debt was already kind of at massive record highs before coronavirus. Household debt was also at a record high. So we had a debt challenge before. It constrains us because we do have to pay it back. Even before the crisis, we were going to be spending $17 billion this year servicing that debt, even before the coronavirus spike in debt. And many of us could think of a better use for $17 billion, I think, than servicing that debt. So we have to pay it down, but we have to be responsible about it. We shouldn't have the kind of radical austerity model that says you pay it back, as soon as you can. You pay it back over a responsible period of time. How we grow the economy is the key consideration there. And then once you have a sense of that and a handle on that, then people will put up proposals for spending changes or tax changes or whatever. I guess our view there is, don't do that in a way that cruels the recovery. Ross Gittins in the Herald has written about this. Stephen Koulos has talked about this. You don't want to make your fiscal objectives when it comes to budget repair. You don't want to make them an economic problem, because the economic problem creates issues for your budget down the track anyway.
Mm. You mentioned earlier, and there's been a question on the R&D side, in terms of getting that right, creating the commercialization scenario for stronger growth. Are there any quick points you see in terms of getting R&D right for Australia?
Well, the government has on the table their proposals for the R&D tax changes. So really the first cab off the rank, I think, will be some sort of clarification or confirmation that what they were proposing to do beforehand is still their intention. I don't know when we'll get that clarification, perhaps in the October budget or ideally before then. Mm. So I think that's kind of the first piece we need some sense of, some certainty around. And we're prepared to be constructive about that, obviously. But beyond that, what universities look like during and in the immediate aftermath of this crisis is going to be a big piece of the puzzle. If we don't maintain or salvage that kind of research capacity across our university system, it will be harder then to commercialise their ideas. As a lot of universities are kind of cutting back on their commitments, it may be that some of those are in their kind of advanced industrial research capacity, which would be a tragedy, frankly, for this. I think the CSIRO needs to play a role here. If we're to have the right kind of growth after the crisis, we need to have that right kind of foundational research happening too. And Anthony Albanese will be talking about some of these things in a more detail in the next week or two. But it's a key part of our thinking, which is how do we take this appetite for relying on expert advice to get us through this crisis, how do we apply that into the future in terms of the quality and nature of our ideas and how we can turn them into jobs, which is really the function of R&D. But the tax bit, the universities bit are really the foundational planks. And we'll be hearing more about that, clearly in the lead up to and in the budget.
So I think that's a really important point you make. I mean, obviously the universities and their sort of scientific capability and the role of science has been extraordinary in terms of the information about the crisis and the management of this pandemic. What do you see as the future for science and the role of expertise in general in terms of policy making? People have talked about climate change, even, I guess, the economy. What do you see as the relevance of that sort of expertise in terms of policy making going forward? And has politics got that right in this country, or do you see a shift happening more generally? Just final question.
Yeah. Thanks, Anton. Well, there's certainly been a shift, and it would be best for us if that's an enduring shift rather than a kind of a historical oddity. We have become accustomed in the decision-making world, whether it's corporate or government, but also in the broader community. I mean, almost every day we hear about relying on expert advice, health advice to deal with the crisis. And ideally that would translate into other areas. Climate's the most obvious, prominent, newsworthy part of that. But in other parts, as well, I mean, you come back to the CSIRO, for example, the some of the work that they've done on the economy in recent times is just terrific. And, you know, we need to amplify those kinds of quality considered views. You think about technology, you know, some of the work that my friend Andrew Charlton does at Alpha Beta about the growth possibilities of getting better at adapting and adopting technology. You know, all of these sorts of things, they should be far more prominent. And it's partly our fault in the political world because, you know, we prosecute our political differences so robustly and that gets a lot of attention. But imagine if we could get at least some of that attention onto some of this really good thinking that happens in our country. And if we did that, we wouldn't just make the economic and political conversation better, but we'd make the outcomes better. You know, there's a lot of good thinking going on that doesn't get the attention it deserves.
Jim, thank you very much for your time today. It's been great talking with you, and I'm sure the viewers have really appreciated your answering so many of the questions as well. We certainly look forward to ongoing conversations, hearing your experiences again managing another major crisis in terms of the thinking that's required and some of the public policy options that start to generate out of that. And we wish you well, and we look forward to continuing to discuss these big long-term issues for Australia with you.
I look forward to it too, Anton. Thanks so much for the opportunity.